if you realize that your job is just simply to connect with a human and give them a better life, and all the nerd things, all the knobs we turn, all the keywords we search for, and then all the links we put into the landing pages is just should be in line with, did I connect with the human and offer them a better life? Then you would naturally go, oh, if they search this, they probably want this. And if you're being an empathetic, awesome marketer, you would say, well, how about this? Welcome to the Maven Marketing Podcast. Today is Maven Monday. I'm your host, Brandon Welch, and I am joined today by the search engine shaker, the efficiency maker, the conventional rule breaker, Ryan Baker.
Hey!
His middle name is the Conversion King. He has managed well over 500 Google ad accounts and the tens of millions of dollars of ad spend. He is a regular call for some of the biggest, baddest gurus in the industry. And because of our history, we are lucky enough, I'm lucky enough to work with him, and he now oversees all of the search at Frank and Maven, has for a while now, and we have, we've been trying to make this happen for a while, but we got him in the studio today, and we are going to equip you with everything you need to know to be profitable and prosperous in search engines in 2024 and maybe beyond.
Yeah.
What do you have to say for yourself?
Well, I mean, yeah, all of those things are true. And thank you for that sparkling intro. The middle name thing, my parents were nerds, so it's a
yeah.
thing. But I just wanted to thank
Ryan
you for...
Ryan Conversion King Baker, yes.
It was weird, but it caught on. Yeah. So when Google Cult Ads came thing. Out, it really caught on. I just wanted to thank you for giving me this foray into my sweatshirt modeling career. I've been working toward this my whole life, and I'm excited to transfer out of digital marketing and into modeling.
You know, he is. It was a tough game, but it was a bribe. We said, listen, we'll let you model our sweatshirt. He has one of two of the new official Frank and Maven sweatshirts.
And let me tell you, these things are warm, they are soft, and they will be stolen by my wife immediately.
They're very cuddly. And
yeah, actually, so I kind of have the keys to these. So the first person that sends a question about search engine marketing for me to answer for you and help you out, I will tackle the security guard and get you a sweatshirt like this, a hoodie. However, you got to send it to MavenMonday@frankandmaven.com.
Yes. Send your question to Frank and Maven. Sorry, MavenMonday@frankandmaven.com. He will tackle Nate, the camera guy, who
It'll
keeps
be
lock and key over the swag stock around here. I was going to say, he tried a long time to get a sweatshirt modeling gig. Mm. Nobody was calling him.
Yep.
Were you starting to sweat it?
You hood to make a pun.
I hood to make a pun.
Hooded.
Okay, we had to get one in. All right, this is the place where we answer your real-life marketing questions so you can eliminate waste in advertising, grow your business, and achieve the big dream. And the big dream for so many that we've worked in the past is about getting in front of that customer.
Yep.
And when you were at any phase of growing your business, it's how can I get a little more? And search engines typically is the fastest way to get the phone to ring.
Mm-hmm.
So it is, I would say that's what Frank and Maven was originally kind of built on.
Yeah.
Was our ability to do that. Caleb and I, back in the old days, would rebuild accounts 10, 20, 30 times so we could, you know, make the phone ring for our friends Keith and Tyler. And man, it was like we were just scrappy and we were soaking it all up. And then over the years, we built this team that does it. And now we're working with, you know, the likes of Ryan, the highest levels. He happens to live in our town, which is probably the only reason we had the opportunity to work with him.
It doesn't hurt.
Yeah. And we go way back though.
Yeah, we do. I have known you since half your life ago.
Half my life ago.
Which is also basically half my life ago. Yes. We're almost the same age. I'm actually just a little older than
Are
Brandon.
Really?
So I have more life
more
experience.
Gray hairs.
I'm
yeah.
Like, yeah.
You have one more child and one more gray hairs than I do.
Right. Yes.
So yeah, we've been in the music industry together, and then we both became marketers. We were competitors, friendly competitors, but
yeah kind of.
Yeah.
You can't compete with Brandon. You can't compete with Frank and Maven.
No, that's not true. That's not true. But when it comes to search, we're going to cover, Ryan has laid out five things he thinks you guys need to know about search coming up. And man, the game is changing. And so I'm just going to give an overview, and I'm going to lob you all of these softballs to knock out of the park, because I know you eat, breathe, and sleep this stuff.
Mm.
I would have considered myself a guru at one point, but I am a manager of gurus at this point. So I trust experts like Ryan to give me the latest and greatest, and it is changing faster than it ever has.
It's insane.
I tell people a lot, for what it's worth, we spend millions of dollars a year on search engines here at Frank and Maven. We get great results. It is a bucking bull at times, but I tell people all the time, even when Caleb and I were essentially working, you know, 40 hours a week apiece just to make campaigns produce, what we have to do now is like 10 times harder than that. I'm not saying that lightly. We have to work 10 times harder to get the same result.
Yep.
And so that's why we have heavier horsepower. And there are five major things that are changing and that you need to be aware of. And I'm just going to lay these out and we're going to go into each one of them.
Yeah.
AI. Al.
Super hot topic.
Al has complicated the game.
Yeah.
So Ryan's going to tell you about the latest in that. Google is making things more expensive just because.
Whoa.
Good times. Mm. Conversion tracking is getting more complex. Match types are a disaster. Speaking of matches.
Train wreck.
Speaking
Dumpster
of matches.
Fire.
You know what else Ryan's going to throw in when you send a search engine question? A Frank and Maven candle called Frank Incense with a cute little box of matches.
This thing smells amazing. I'm also taking this home, but
yes.
You can get one too.
Yes. Match types. He's going to tell you all about that. Are a disaster. And we're going to actually, you know what? The fifth, I'm going to make you listen and wait for.
Yeah.
Because it's really the one that takes care of all four.
It's the clincher.
Yep. Cliffhanger. AI.
Yeah.
How is AI complicating the game for search engines?
Well, aside from just generally stirring up a lot of confusion about something that's already confusing, it makes everyone think that they can do it without knowing it, without understanding it. And so it's increased competition, but that competition is just throwing money at things. So in one way, it's kind of improved your competitive advantage, and in another way, it's taken it away.
Mm-hmm. Level the playing field.
It's a kind of level the playing field for people to access Google Ads, but to operate at a more efficient, higher level.
Yes.
Of operation, you really need to understand the platform.
So, even a couple of years ago, I would say that if you were just 10-20% better than somebody who might just have a, you know, an internal marketing manager or some, you know, Swiss Army knife of a marketer that just went in and put some keywords in. Like, first of all, it used to be you could get results if you just put something in.
Yeah.
Like, it was going to work to some level, right?
Mm-hmm.
And that goes, in my experience, you know, business owner or business owner plus their marketing person goes, hey, let's enter some keywords for, you know, my plumbing business or my mechanic business or my law firm or whatever. And, you know, there was a lot of waste probably that happened, but Google was cheap enough.
Mm-hmm.
It was generally not oversaturated enough with other competitors. And as long as you were in a medium market, not like a huge city, like you were going to get some calls, you were going to get some clicks, and you might not have been able to diagnose at the level that a high caliber marketer does. But you're going to go, that $1,000 I spent got me something. I feel like it did, right?
Yeah.
And all my friends that are listening and all of our listeners now who are primarily, you know, managing marketing spend for a small, medium business are going, even in the, what I would consider a high caliber environment of Frank and Maven are going, huh, that money ain't going near as far as it used to go. And we have some people that spend $20,000, $30,000, $40,000 a month.
Mm-hmm.
And it's because Google, and if you log in and look at it, the platform in and of itself is giving the illusion that anybody can come to it.
Yeah.
Is that?
Yeah, they have very, very clean and easy, simple, very clean and simple startup wizards that any small business owner, they're designed specifically for small business owners to come in, set up accounts, and it gives all of the control to Google. So you just tell them, hey, here's what I want to show up for.
Yes.
And Google's like, we'll take care of that for you and not completely.
You don't need to worry about
money.
That button. Like the buttons that we used to press, you know. Metaphorically,
they're gone.
Actually, they were buttons.
Yeah,
they're taking stuff away now. There's still ways, like it's not taking the.
You can access them.
It's not taking the skill set or the advantage away from having a high caliber manager. And there's a lot of good ones. Like there's a lot of marketers that I don't really believe in. Like there's a lot of parts of marketing that is like, you better find a really good one. That's hard to do. It's not hard to find somebody who has express knowledge in AdWords.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Now they may not be the best, but
finding competence in search engine marketing is not as hard as it once was.
Yes.
But I do have some agency owner friends who have said that it's getting harder because the platform operates in some ways the same way that it used to, but in other ways, it's night and day difference. Yes. And if you don't keep up with changes, 10 years experience doesn't mean anything because it's a completely different platform in a lot of ways than it used to be.
And what I've seen is that... You got to be really good problem solver. Not there's rule followers that go, oh, I learned from the course that you do this, and then this, and that linear cookie cutter equation is just gone. So you have to have an intuitive person that can go, I'm going to break the rules here a little bit or break what used to work 2 years ago to solve this problem.
Yeah.
And man, I cannot think of an account we haven't had to do that to some degree with.
Yeah. Yeah, so a lot of the difficulty that AI is bringing to the table is how much control they're taking away.
Yes.
How much data and information they're hiding behind the black box machine learning algorithm, fill in the blank. And if you don't understand what the algorithm's trying to do and how to feed the algorithm what it wants while also giving the customer what they want, because that's the end goal.
Yes.
And Google is trying to give the customer what they want, but they don't have the technology yet. The AI isn't there.
There weren't enough good marketers to make it work predictably for Google.
Well, I think the problem is not so much that they were trying to get good marketers. It's that they were trying to get maybe economists or people to make them more money.
More and more money, yes.
Because, so I actually was talking to somebody that has access to tens of thousands of Google Ads accounts and the data therein. It's anonymous data, but he was telling me that Google has what they call auto-applied recommendations, and they will make recommendations for your accounts.
Yeah, and anybody who logs in, it's a loud notification.
Right in your face.
Yeah, they're like, ooh, your account needs to be optimized. You better auto-apply all these 147 things you got to do.
And they say they have a metric called optimization score saying that if you increase your optimization score by 40%, your account will improve by 40%, which is a bold-faced lie.
I thought you were going to say something else and I was going to agree with you, but
well, it's also that. Yeah. But. So if you take their recommendations, what he found through his studies of all these accounts and the accounts that use the auto-applied recommendations, they actually on average saw a 21% decrease in performance over time because of these auto-applied recommendations. And they saw a significant increase in ad spend.
I've had the experience. Frank and Maven is not an agency that keeps everything behind closed curtain. And some of our clients and some of my friends over the years like to get in and just look at it. And we love that. We love to teach and share as much as we can about that. And sometimes, like before we gave kind of the word of warning, when these auto-apply recommendations started coming in, they would just go, oh, that looks like a good idea. I'll help Brandon and the team out. And I'll click, 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 click. And then like, you know, 2 or 3 weeks later, like we'd be like, what in the world's going on? We go back and look at the history. It's like, oh, they added all this junk. And so Google is trying to make this utopian world where any business owner can come in and put a dollar in the machine and don't worry about it. Google will take care of it. And you don't need to do anything else. Don't scrutinize or ask questions. We'll take care of that for you. And it's just not working out.
No.
Yet. And so what I would say to land this part of the equation, if you were new to the AdWords game, hire somebody to at least teach you well. If you are an advertiser that has, you know, I would say $30,000, $40,000, $50,000 to spend in the medium level and you're a, you know, local business or even an e-com or whatever, I would say it is very, very unlikely that it's worth your money to try to do that yourself.
Yeah.
Unless you just legit enjoy it and you legit want to be that nerd and that's one of the things you want to hold on to. But I don't know many CEOs or founders or COOs or even managers that should do that.
If you want to run a good business, you don't have time to also be in the weeds with Google Ads.
Yes. And try. Yeah, exactly. And it's a weeds equation, man. I promise you it is. And then the third thing I would say is know how to ask the right questions.
Yeah.
What would you say that somebody who's letting somebody manage their account should be asking?
So that's a really good question. If you don't know anything about search engine marketing or about Google Ads or you know anything like that, mm-hmm. then what you want to ask is, what should I be looking for?
Mm-hmm.
How do I know if it's working?
Mm-hmm.
And just really high level questions like that.
Yeah.
So you don't need to understand everything going on behind it, in, unless you want to.
Right.
But then you're going to get a nerd talking to you for an hour.
If somebody asked me that question, I would say, what is it costing me to get an opportunity to talk to somebody?
Yeah.
A question I think isn't asked a lot is, where have you seen waste? Because I promise you, when Google changes something, everybody gets waste. What waste are you eliminating? And it's not, don't look at that as a bad thing. Like your SEM person should be coming to you saying, there was waste and
yeah.
I found it and I deleted it. And that should be thumbs up, not like, how in the heck did you let that happen? Because it's going to happen, right? Yeah.
90-95% of managing a Google Ads account is eliminating waste.
And that's in the name of all this AI stuff. That's why it's such a crazy thing, because Google took the friction off a lot of things we'd have to go in and individually manage and change,
mm-hmm.
and they just kind of generalized it. And so digging under the surface to find problems is actually more the game of optimization than it is like, you know, it used to be like, could you find the right keywords? Well, that's not hard to do anymore. So
right.
Last thing I would say about that, be very, very wary of shiny objects and new features and things like Performance Max.
Mm.
Google is pushing this down people's throats. And this is going to lead to the second point beautifully.
Oh, yeah.
The reason Google is doing this and the reason you should be very skeptical of all their new features is because they are making things more expensive.
Mm-hmm.
They are trying to please shareholders and show, even 20 years after AdWords was a invention, that dates me saying AdWords, Google Ads now, right? They are trying to perpetually expand their revenues.
Yeah.
And what happens when you've built an entire economy or an entire store off of, there's three or four spots that they're selling inventory on, right?
Mm-hmm.
And now essentially, the evolution of advertisers, it's like there's enough people in enough cities in enough categories bidding that those four spots are perpetually filled up.
Yeah.
And so it's not like there's unsold inventory. And so they go, oh, wow, we're sold out. So what do we have to do? We have to make new inventory.
Yeah.
And what are we going to do? Well, we're going to, first of all, they're going to say, well, you know what? You can't control our inventory anymore. We're going to put this little AI thing on it. And so we'll control the supply and demand a little more. And that's what they want. They want their preference and their advantage of control on the inventory so they can charge more for it, fit more people in a smaller window by organization. And then even when that kind of ran dry,
yep.
And what my observation is, 2020, 2021, when the world was just going bonkers, COVID, you know, everybody's buying online, like instant, like major increases for Google.
Yeah.
And then that starts going down. And because shareholders don't care that it was just a bubble, they go, what are you going to do to give us our revenues?
Yeah.
And Google's like, we'll pull a rabbit out of a hat. Don't mind this over here. We've got new revenues, new inventory. That's when we started seeing, you know, after it was, I think it was a third quarter earnings report or something that came out that Google was losing. We started seeing a lot more Performance Max, a lot more forcing these features.
Yeah. And with the new features and Performance Max and anything new Google comes out with, A, there are always going to be bugs. So it's best to give it a little bit of time for those to get ironed out. But they always explain it in a really good way.
Mm.
So the theory and concept behind Performance Max is wonderful. It actually fits in really well with the Maven method. The problem is the execution is 100% geared toward making more money for Google and not for you.
Yes. They either have not figured it out, which I would find hard to believe, or they ignore what's actually best for the user.
Yeah.
Because grand scheme of search engines, if you realize that your job is just simply to connect with a human and give them a better life, and all the nerd things, all the knobs we turn, all the keywords we search for, and then all the links we put into the landing pages should be in line with, did I connect with the human and offer them a better life? Then you would naturally go, oh, if they search this, they probably want this. And if you're being an empathetic, awesome marketer, you would say, well, how about this?
Yeah.
Would you like it in a box? Would you like it with a fox? I have that for you.
Yeah.
It is Ritz-Carlton level. I can do that for you, right? Yeah. But instead, Google wants to go, nah, we're going to use data. We're going to use these, you know, this big set of big data to kind of blend it all together and try to follow numbers instead of human desires. And mm-hmm. I think that's where they've lost their way.
Yeah, they really can't understand human desire as well as they're trying to, even with all of the data they have. It's still making cold yes. analytical predictions, and a lot of times it's coming up wrong.
Yes.
Now, there is a way that I have seen Performance Max work really, really well, but we can touch on that in point five.
Point five. Okay, cool.
Yeah, because it's very related.
It's a cliffhanger. Another cliffhanger. So, Performance Max, if you're seeing this, if you're doing your own AdWords, be very, very wary of it. We've tested it to the tune of more money than I'd like to say, and it didn't work out. And some
more often than not, yeah,
yeah. And this is going to lead to point three. It's going to make you think it's working, but it's actually not. So Performance Max is just simply Google forcing your inventory wherever it sees fit, which really is just we can spread your dollar out thinner over these really weird places yeah. that don't actually lead to conversions.
And they hide a lot of the data, and a lot of the conversions or maximized performance that
yes.
you get is actually from your brand name,
yes,
which people are searching and clicking on because yeah. the work you've done there.
So instead of you paying $5,000 and all of that goes to being in those like top three or four positions on search, they're going, well, we'll put a little bit over here in this obscure site. We'll put a little bit here in a random YouTube video. And mm-hmm. they can count it as an impression and charge you for it because you agreed to it by clicking yes, Performance Max. But it's not the way people buy. People are still going to, if they really, really want something or really want to find that company or that number or whatever, they're going to the search engine, typing in the name, and you want all your money there, in my opinion, not these other corners of the internet where it's a mystery, right?
Find demand. So fulfill that demand.
So yeah, Google's making things more expensive just because they need to make more money.
Yep.
So that should inform all of your skepticisms about the system. And I'm not saying Google doesn't have a place.
Yep.
A lot of people are going to walk away going, well, how do we leave Google? I'm going, we can't and we shouldn't.
Yeah.
But understand that the game it was 2 years ago and definitely the game it was 5 years ago is not the game today. In addition to all that funny smoke and mirror stuff they're doing with AI and all that, they're just legit raising the price of their inventory, saying, actually, I have an article here from our friends at Search Engine Land, big research, search engine research firm. Google quietly increases ad spend to meet targets, claims the executives. The search engine reportedly raises prices by up to 10% without informing advertisers. So just because it's like going to a restaurant, yeah, steak was $35 yesterday, it's $65 today or $45 today or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Google has admitted to quietly tweaking advertising auctions to meet revenue targets. Up until this, Google has largely been supply and demand, and that was the beauty of it.
Yeah.
And whoever was the most competitive, whoever's the most aggressive, and whoever's the most satisfying to the customer won.
Yeah.
And now they're just going, that's fine. You guys still play that game, but boop.
Yep.
Boop. That's what they do.
Yeah. So what was $5 every click 5 years ago is now $45 every click.
I'm seeing it. I have an account right now that... Literally the same thing. And the analogy would be actually more like $7 or $8 for like roofing company.
Oh, yeah.
In Tulsa or Bentonville, I have two of those right now. Now, it's literally $40.
Yeah.
And you could argue some of that's supply and demand, but a lot of it is just perpetual, we're going to make it more competitive. So
there's a lot of competition there, and competition does drive up prices, but so does Google when they want to reach their quarterly numbers.
That's exactly right. And they can do it because they are Google. So, they're frequently raising the price. And then the last thing I would say, because of that, advertisers that used to be able to enter or like do a little bit of good with a couple grand a month,
mm-hmm.
it's really, really tough.
Yeah. Yeah. I was explaining to a client at one point that we couldn't have weekly meetings because there wasn't enough data to talk about. Your $1,500 every month, well, you can get maybe 37 clicks if you're lucky and you have cheap keywords.
Yes.
You can get maybe 37 clicks. Sometimes you get 4 clicks in a week.
And guys like Brian and our team and me, we don't know what dog to chase with 37 clicks.
Yeah.
That doesn't tell a compelling story.
Yeah.
Over 30 days, if I've only gotten a click or two a day,
yeah,
I'm going, there's nothing here that sticks out high enough out of the ground for me to go, that's the one to chase. And the best search engine practices are generally put a group of things out there, find the winners,
mm-hmm.
follow the winners, put more money towards the winners. I'm talking about the winning keywords, the winning landing pages, and the winning mm-hmm. ad copy.
Yeah.
And because, $2,000 used to buy you a couple hundred clicks, generally.
Yeah.
maybe even more.
Oh, yeah.
We go, a couple hundred clicks with a, you know, well managed. You can go, okay, I've got a hunch here. I got a 50% chance that's my winner, right?
Yeah.
Now it's like, oh boy, I spent $2,000, got, you know, a data set of 30, yeah. 35, 37 clicks, and I'm going, they're all ones. It's not like there's a...
Mm-hmm. You get one click with a search, yeah. So the name of the game, you do need to start with a deep understanding of the customer, the market, the business, but you do need to... Human behavior is difficult to predict,
yes.
And you do need to have data to make those wise decisions.
Yep. The ante is just higher.
Yeah.
To get the right amount of money to optimize, it's like 1 + 1 = 2. It's like 2 + 2 = 10.
Yeah.
And what I mean by there is you got to have a budget over a certain level that you really hit that efficiency. And I hate that because Google over the years has been the tool that we take, you know, advertisers who are just, you know, established enough to kind of get in the game.
Yeah.
And it's like, for 20, 30 grand a year, I can get you to the level to be a real advertiser. And now it's tougher.
It's harder.
I'm saying it's completely impossible, but in a lot of cases, it's, you got to be spending 50 grand to get to the level you got to be to optimize. So
yeah.
Things are more expensive, just like everything else in our world.
Yeah.
Okay. With that, on the note of more expensive, proving, this is the point number 3, conversion tracking is getting more complex.
Yeah.
Conversion meaning used to be we knew exactly what worked. We knew we put a keyword out there. We knew essentially to the minute when it worked.
Yeah.
And to the minute what it cost us, and to the minute what the cost of that result was, which is a conversion, right?
Yep.
In our world, for most of our advertisers that are listeners,
phone call, form fill.
Yep.
That's 90%.
They click the ad and Google was tracking. They click the ad from this keyword. They went to this landing page and turned into a lead.
Yep.
You got emailed, form fill. Or they just immediately click call and mm-hmm. they could tell, well, that was associated with this keyword.
Yeah.
Roofer in Tulsa or whatever. And,
yeah, over the years,
privacy, how are they changing that? It's not that clear anymore.
Yeah. So over the years, privacy has become more of a concern amongst the users of these platforms. Mm. And to kind of satisfy those people and not get sued, Google has hidden a lot of data, including at least 40% of the things people typed in. We call them search terms that triggered your ads. Even if those keywords led to conversions, Google will not always tell you what keyword it was, what search term
yes,
it
they
was.
They put it in this not provided category.
Yep, yep. And so we don't get all the data we need. Now, that's not conversion tracking per se that's causing that, but there are a lot of other changes. Apple is leading the charge on a lot of this that are causing us to have to track things differently. And Google is leaning more and more on requiring email addresses as part of this tracking equation. And so you need to turn on something called enhanced conversions, which requires CSS selectors and, you know, sometimes auto collect
nerd stuff
features,
in the back end of the website. Yeah.
It doesn't always work the way it's supposed to. And so you sometimes can't trust the numbers you're seeing. You may actually have more leads coming from your ad platform than what your ad platform is showing. Which hurts the ad platform a bit because it can't use that data to optimize using the algorithms, the AIs, and all those things. But the difficulty is that you can't always use the simpler, straightforward methods you used to use. So you need to use complex things like Google Tag Manager and tags and triggers and data layer variables. And
did you write that down, 8th camera guy?
You got that? Cool.
He's got that. He wrote it down.
Comprehensive course coming soon. So it's getting a lot more complicated, and it's getting harder and harder to get accurate numbers from the Google Ads dashboard.
Yes.
From what happened, and people are using a lot more platforms. People are using more devices. So you may have somebody searching on a phone to understand what you offer and how you can help them, and maybe they'll call, or maybe they'll go and fill out a form on your website on their laptop. And maybe there are several days between those actions.
And the good part about that actually is, and it's blowing people's minds because they were used to going, Mr. Ad Guy, did I give you $5,000 and what did I get in return? And he was like, well, let me see, you got 19 people for that. And then the conclusion is the advertiser, and maybe rightfully perpetuated by the likes of search engine people, but the advertiser goes, cool, that was all there was to the equation. I put money in search, and then there was this magic, you know, machine thing that captured a customer, and there was no other influence involved. That actually has never been the case.
Yeah.
Comscore and even Google have long said, you're giving a lot of credit to search engines, and it wasn't actually the search engine in entirety. It is things like online reputation. It is things like how long has your business been established? It is things like referrals from a friend. It is things like the billboard they drove by or the corner of the street you were on for the last 82 years.
Mm-hmm.
And then people have this collective understanding of who you are. And then they go to the search engine and they trust you. Like, just the inherent establishment of your business, and if you do any other advertising and branding, was always in effect, yep. Right?
Yeah.
Foreshadowing for point five. But now, so there's not even the illusion, or there's less of an illusion that, ooh, it was all the search.
Right.
So truth is, for a long time, it hasn't been all the search, unless mm-hmm. you're brand new. And so my guys that are for a long time are used to, like, you know, $50, $60, $70 leads or like extremely cheap customer acquisition that they can go, you know, every $100 I put into Google, I get a customer that made me $3,000 or $4,000. And I'm like, that's a beautiful equation. But A, it looks uglier to begin with. It probably is uglier, but it's not quite as ugly as it looks now.
Yeah.
Because they're blurring the data.
Yeah.
Fair?
Fair. Yeah.
So there's more happening in your Google account than you're able to see, most likely, especially if you're spending at any level of scale.
Always.
And what you need to know about that is don't freak out about cost per lead.
Yeah.
Especially if there aren't other confirming factors.
Yeah. It may be reported as higher than it actually is.
Mm-hmm.
And what your ads are doing for you is going farther than what you can see in the platform.
Yeah. It's in that category. Sort of, you know, the tomorrow customer and all of that. And I'm not saying search is the best way to do that, but
yeah,
you know, there is a reality that there's probably more going on than you see, because conversion tracking and privacy is perpetually.
Yeah, the primary goal of search is to show up for those today customers that are searching for your products and services.
Yes.
But it has expanded, which is why it's called Google Ads now instead of AdWords, to include a lot more tomorrow customer.
That, weren't they? Yeah.
Yeah. Big brains over there.
Yes. Okay. Quick recap. AI has complicated the game.
Mm-hmm.
Competitive advantage is not as easy as it once was. And kind of all the lower knowledge people and the higher knowledge people are getting suppressed into like this middle homogenous, like, result.
Mm-hmm.
Still, there is still such thing as a competitive advantage.
Yeah.
It's less than there
it's
used
not
to
writing
be.
Better ads.
Yes, we didn't even get into that, but just trust me on that. It's not about, like, they're taking ad copy a little bit more out of the mix.
Yes.
Google. So that's point number one. AI is complicated the game. Point number two. Google is making things more expensive just because. We didn't even talk about the antitrust lawsuit, but they're getting sued. They're not going to lose because they're Google. But
right.
Matter of fact, the conclusion here. The outcome of the landmark case could bring significant changes of Google to the future of the internet, but it's equally likely the trial will result in no changes. Huge antitrust lawsuit. Basically, there's people suing Google saying you're monopolizing and you are conspiring to raise the price with no competitive advantage in the market. And you're too big, the whole monopoly
thing. Yeah.
And that's happening right
Can
now.
Confirm.
Literally right now. In court today, it's happening.
Yeah.
Not like happened a few weeks ago. There's like a 10-week trial going on, started in November. So they're raising prices just because, and they're getting scrutinized for it.
Mm-hmm. They are rigging auctions as well, but we didn't talk about that. We won't.
Rigging auctions, yes.
Yeah.
It's bad.
Yeah. Deciding who
Google's
shows up first in the results.
Google's a necessary evil, and they're getting more evil.
Yep.
While remaining just as necessary.
The whole do no evil thing went out the window a long time
ago. Yeah, it really
ago.
Did. So point number three, this is supposed to be a quick recap. I just took 2 minutes to recap what we talked about. Point number three is tracking what's happening is getting more complex.
Yeah.
So your results aren't quite as black and white as they once were.
Yeah.
It's okay. You can still advertise with faith as long as you have good, you know, principles in place.
Doing the right thing still leads to results. You just can't always see those results in the Google Ads dashboard.
Yes. It's not instant gratification is tougher and tougher with Google Ads. Okay. Point number four, we're not going to spend a ton of time on this because this gets into nerd weeds, but
yeah.
Match types.
Quick and surfacey. So match types is essentially Google's way of determining how relevant someone's search is to the keywords you're targeting. And that determines when your ad shows up. So you have three options: broad match, phrase match, and exact match. And back in the day, broad meant broad.
Yes.
Phrase meant if you search this phrase with something before or after, it shows up. And then so, exact was exactly that search.
Quick practical example there.
Yeah.
If I were estate planning attorney in Dallas, Texas.
Yep.
Okay. And I entered that and I said, hey, Google, I want to show up for estate planning attorney in Dallas.
Mm-hmm.
And they're asking, okay, do you want us to match that exactly? Is it only when you say it has to literally be estate planning attorney Dallas or your ad won't show mm-hmm. that the person types? Or are you willing for us to be like, you know, have that in a sentence, like mm-hmm. best estate planning attorney in Dallas?
Right.
Other words around it. Mm-hmm. And we'll still show your ad.
Yep.
Or do you want us just to kind of determine loosely what estate planning attorney means?
Yeah.
And so there might be someone that said, you know, wills and trust attorney, and Google will go, ah, that sounds like it. Broadly, we're going to match that search with this ad and then therefore charge you when somebody searched something outside the match type.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. Or estate planning attorney in Fort Worth, you know, so it's close,
yeah,
it's just closely related.
Right.
So it's what they call a close variant.
And generally we would used to use all three types. We'd use the broad to find extra intent that we didn't think of,
yeah,
find extra keywords and to kind of cover our bases until the broad got out of whack. And it, you know, within a month or two, you're like, ah, now I know enough of the actual phrases that I've put in exact.
Yep.
Because they charge more for broad match. Effectively.
You spend more money with broad match because you show up for more searches.
More waste.
Yeah.
Yes.
More waste.
Okay. So that was the old days.
Yeah.
And now they've essentially taken these, what used to be, we like Ryan and I and Caleb and, you know, Tanner and everybody over the years here and Audrey and Leslie and everybody's like, we go in there and we're like, we would like to, we know this is a really expensive keyword, so we would only like to show for estate planning attorney Dallas.
Yeah. So if you choose an exact match for estate planning attorney Dallas and you only want to show up for that, then you will only show for 1,160. There are seriously over 1,000 searches can match to your exact type match.
So they've taken away the specificity.
Yeah.
Specificity.
Yeah. They have taken away the precision. Because Google has shifted from matching based on relevance of search, and they are trying,
because they're
with a machine, to match the intent of the search. So they say, oh, estate planning attorney?
Yep.
Well, if somebody's searching car accident attorney, well, this is an attorney.
Yeah. And they're taking liberties. They're taking...
It's not always that liberties. Way. But we have seen with an exact match keyword.
Yes.
Targeting a window yes. supplier, window replacement yep. company, a search for a roofing company come through.
Yes.
Because Google thought the intent was the same.
Oh, they're looking for windows. They probably need a roof too.
Yep.
Yeah. It's close.
That is not accurate.
It was exactly kind of close is yep. what they're saying.
So
60% of the time it works every time. Yeah.
So the end result is that you have to spend way more time filtering out the waste and getting to the good data to make wise decisions
yes.
and increase lead flow, decrease yep. cost per lead.
Yes.
And so exact match is broad match. Phrase match is, oh my goodness, that's a really yep. broad match. And broad match is just show for anything.
I predict a Netflix documentary coming in the future about some whistleblower that was like, hey, this was happening and somebody had pressure on them to make revenue and they were telling me to skew the algorithm and it wasn't in a Google official update or anything. And they're like, yeah, and it resulted in, you know, wasted money for a lot of people.
I would watch that.
And the truth is, consumers will cry less about this. They can get away with a lot more sins.
Yeah.
Showing Ryan a roofing ad when he actually wanted a window company because Ryan, in a split second, just goes, "Eh, I scrolled past it and I didn't click it."
Yeah.
Or I
clicked the first result and then I just clicked back and I went to the next one.
Yeah. It cost him 4 seconds of his time to go, oh, well, that wasn't a window company.
But it cost you $50.
Yeah. Meanwhile, you paid cost per, you know, that kind of cost per click. So what you need to know, it's a disaster because Google is cooking the algorithm.
Yep.
And yeah.
But if you understand how to use the waste filtration system in Ooh. Google Ads or the negative keywords, they work, the match types are there, which a lot of advertisers don't know that there are different
yes.
match types for negative keywords. They work the same way that positive keyword match types used to work.
Yes.
And with slight changes, but it's it's important to understand how those work so that you can go in and make those changes to filter out as much waste as possible from one change.
We should start a company called Search Waste Management.
Oh,
we could sponsor golf
tournaments. I want a trash truck.
Waste Management Open, or what? Where are the? It's a big golf tournament out in Arizona. Waste Management. You said Waste Management. I was like, ooh.
I'm not a sports ball man.
Sports ball man. Okay. Yeah, he's too busy
modeling sweatshirts.
Turning knobs.
Not modeling turning knobs.
Yeah,
exactly. I do the work.
Yes. Okay. So AI is complicated the game. Google's making things more expensive just because. Conversion tracking is getting more complex. Match types are disaster, which means there's more waste. Mm-hmm. And it has all led to this giant conclusion. What is the most sure way to win in search engine marketing?
If you want to win in search engine marketing in 2024 or beyond, and this has always been the case, you need to have a trusted, recognizable, and I'd say widely known brand. The stronger your brand, the more you will be searched directly by name, the more you will be recognized and therefore get clicks, which leads to cheaper clicks because of the way the system works, when people see you in the search results. And the more people will come to you without you having to pay for clicks. There is no downside to having a strong brand, and it is the number one competitive advantage that no one else can copy.
There you said it. Branding is your best bet.
Branding is your best bet.
I would add a fourth thing.
Yeah.
When they actually get to your page, they already trusted you.
Yeah.
There's already a reputation that precedes you.
There's less time and education needed to win their conversion action or their phone call, their form submission, their share of wallet.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah.
And some random name that popped up on the list doesn't feel as good as somebody they've known and trusted for a long time.
Yeah.
That can show up in a lot of forms. That's what we talk about. That's tomorrow marketing for those who didn't know. Winning over your customers before that gruesome, convoluted, overpriced, tedious moment of the search engine auction.
Mm-hmm.
Winning them over long before that. I have dozens, if not hundreds, of case studies where I can prove that's true. There are some big, big marketers. Les Bennett, or Les Bennett. He's a European guy. Has a fascinating case study with 1,000, it's like a little over 1,000 really big brands.
Mm.
And he tested, he had a methodology for testing targeted advertising and discount promotion and meet them here and try to, you know, win the auction of the day versus just good old fashioned, do the right thing, be a good company, make people feel, and the results aren't even close.
Yeah.
So,
no shock.
And man, it's a lot, it's a lot less stressful.
Yeah. Well, and the wonderful thing is that at the end of the day, this is still coming down to relationships between humans. And everybody wants to complicate things with the metrics and the numbers and the digital everything. And frankly, it comes down to understanding people, understanding what they want, giving them what they want, and building this relationship of trust over time.
Yes. It's coming from a guy who makes his living and feeds 5 beautiful children. By being that digital dork.
Yeah.
I said it.
I am.
I'm one.
It's sweeter than the way my wife says it.
I just paid him a compliment as far as he knows. I did too. And he's seriously one of the best. You can obviously tell by the last 43 minutes that Brian is top of the top in guru land. And trust me, I wanted to say some of the names he's worked with. He wouldn't let me. But like the guys that are... you would see on any major marketing conference are Ryan is on their speed dial, and digital can connect us faster, and we can make the connection and the process easier for the customer.
Mm-hmm.
And showing up when they need us is a huge part of the compassion and like the final step.
Yeah.
But it's not in a vacuum.
Yeah.
And it's not a completely linear equation that only exists there. And so the more you are, guys, I'm talking about, it's not just TV and radio. That's going to leverage this if you do it well. And we've got a bunch of episodes on that. But I'm talking about even sponsoring your employees, kids, football, soccer, hockey, Girl Scout, whatever. I'm talking about showing up at your church or at a good cause in your community and building relationships and loving on people. I'm talking about putting your name on your trucks and driving them around town rather than just, you know, not doing that.
Yeah.
I'm talking about picking up the phone and calling past customers and asking them how they're doing just because.
Mm-hmm.
I'm talking about getting your team together regularly and saying, this is why we do what we do, and we are offering this good in the world. That those sorts of things that build an aura and build a association and build a relationship and build a bond, that it isn't about the stupid dollar.
Yeah.
These are the kind of things that by the time that reputation has preceded you, just like a good reputation of a boy who's trying to get a date with a girl and all of her friends say, yeah, he's a good guy. Like, that's what's happening. And the lot you're courting the customer in that way, when they get to the search engine, it's going to be less about these silly AI dorky shiny objects that all are going to pop up perpetually because Google, the big machine, is always going to make them a thing.
Mm-hmm.
It's going to be a lot easier if they just already like you and yeah. they're looking for you to begin with. So
it's true.
We all know that's true. It's self-evident. It shows up in every area of your life. And you need to know that the prospect of marketing, it's never been more important to be human, to be real, to be liked, trusted.
Yeah.
And that's where I would land it. Do you have any final words?
If you want an unshakable competitive advantage that no one else can copy, in this age of excessive digital focus, of distraction, of chaos and confusion and busyness, show that you care. Like Brandon said, reach out and call a customer.
Mm.
Send a handwritten note, an actual handwritten note.
Ooh, actual.
Yes. Yeah. And just if you can prove that you care and take good care of your customers, this leads to all of the things in the digital world that help us as consumers take out some of the thinking work. So it leads to reviews. Mm. It leads to higher click-through rates, which in the algorithm lowers your cost per click prices, gets you more clicks that convert because they recognize you and trust you and have read your reviews and seen all the wonderful things people are saying about you. It leads to referrals, which cannot be tracked on Google.
Ooh.
It leads and don't cost you any money because it's a transfer of trust from one person to another.
Yes.
For free.
Yeah, it costs just as much money to be remarkable like that as it does to just be average.
Yeah.
Which is nothing.
Do the right thing
yep.
consistently over time, and you will have an unshakable, trusted brand that is loved by your market.
It's a warm and fuzzy day. These sweaters is good advice. Guys, thank you so much for listening. Thank you so much for being here.
It's been my pleasure.
I will get Ryan back for anybody who wants to ask specific questions. You can send those and get a free hoodie to Maven Monday at frankandmaven.com. So send your questions in. There's a lot to dig into. So if you're seeing something in your accounts and you're going, what is going on here? I promise you we can solve it.
Yeah.
And we'd love to do that for, we'll actually pay you to do that in hoodies and candles and matches. We just love to do this. We love to teach. That's what a maven is, an expert with the heart of a teacher. This is Ryan. He is an expert with the heart of a teacher. This is Frank and Maven. We are experts with the heart of a teacher. And we will be back here every Monday answering your real-life marketing questions, because marketers who can't teach you why
are just fancy lie.
Just fancy lie. Have a great week. Hey guys, you may not know this, but last year and a couple years before, we recorded some Christmas tunes as a company, and I am going to leave you with my favorite track off that album, which was not our host today, but Caleb and Sierra singing Have Yourself a Merry Little Christmas. Hope you enjoy.
Yourself a merry little Christmas. From now on, our troubles will be out of sight. Have yourself a merry little Christmas. Make the Yuletide gay. Yourself a merry little Christmas. Yeah.